Hello guys, today in this video we will start the electromagnetic induction, and the very first topic of this chapter is magnetic flux. And magnetic flux is a very important factor in electromagnetic induction. So let us understand first of all that what is magnetic flux. You all have heard initially in electrostatics that what is electric flux. So similarly, magnetic flux is also a physical quantity which is proportional to the number of magnetic field lines passing perpendicularly through a given surface. It means that if we are given two different surfaces and the number of field lines are passing through one surface is greater than that of the surface two, then we can say that the magnetic flux is a quantity which is directly proportional to the number of field lines which are passing perpendicularly through a surface. Hence, the field lines passing through surface 1 is greater than the number of field lines passing through surface 2. Therefore, the magnetic flux of surface 1 would be greater than the magnetic flux of surface 2. But it is not correct to say that a magnetic flux is the number of field lines. In fact, it is a quantity which is proportional to the number of field lines. Okay. So if there are four magnetic field lines passing through a surface, then we cannot say that magnetic flux is 4 units. So it is very important to note that magnetic flux is exactly not the number of field lines passing through a surface perpendicularly. In fact, it is a physical quantity which is proportional to the number of field lines passing perpendicularly through a surface. Now, what is area vector? Now, area vector is also a vector quantity which is perpendicular to the surface, pointing away from the surface, and its magnitude is the magnitude of the area of the surface. For example, let us suppose that this is a surface, this one, and the observer is at this point. This is observer. So, area vector would be a vector which is coming towards the observer like that. And this vector is also perpendicular to the surface with which it is associated. The magnitude of this area vector is the area of the surface with which it is associated. And it is very important to note that area vector is always coming towards the observer. Okay. So if the observer is at this point below the disk or below the surface, then area vector would be pointing in the downward direction for that observer. So area vector is observer dependent also. Now the magnitude of magnetic flux is also the product of area of a surface and the component of magnetic field which is perpendicular to that surface. For example, in this case the magnetic field is at an angle of theta with the area vector, and if we resolve the magnetic field along the area vector like that, then the component would be B cos theta. Now this B cos theta is that component of magnetic field which is perpendicular to the surface, and you can see that this is B cos theta, and hence we can say that flux is equal to the perpendicular component of magnetic field into area of the surface. This is a scalar form. In this form, neither this is a vector nor this is a vector. So we can say that flux will be equal to B perpendicular. Now it is also important to note that this B perpendicular is that perpendicular component of magnetic field which is perpendicular to the surface, not to the area vector. Okay, so B perpendicular is perpendicular magnetic field to the surface. So it is B cos theta into A. So flux is B dot A. You can see that A dot B is opened by the formula A into B into cos theta. So now in this vector form, we can say that this is the net magnetic field and this is the area vector. And this is very simple, as we have already studied in electrostatics that electric flux is also equal to E dot A. Now, electromagnetic induction was discovered by that scientist Faraday, Michael Faraday. And the laws of electromagnetic induction were established by the Faraday, but before establishing the laws, he conducted some experiments which I'll be demonstrating you in this page. So first of all, he used a coil and he used a galvanometer in the coil, and I hope you all know that galvanometer also gives the deflection of the current. So if the current changes its direction, then galvanometer would measure that change in direction also. So this is a galvanometer, and this is a coil, and he used a bar magnet, a strong bar magnet, and he moved that bar magnet towards the coil, and he moved the north pole of that bar magnet towards the coil. He observed that the current induced, some current was induced in the coil due to the movement of this bar magnet, and that current was in the anti-clockwise sense. He observed that. Now, when he moved the bar magnet away from the coil and similar polarity, that he moved north pole away from this coil, then he observed that current changed its direction, and now current was induced in a clockwise sense. Now similarly, when he moved that south pole away from that coil, then he observed that anti-clockwise current was induced, and when he moved that south pole towards the coil, then he observed that clockwise current was induced. Now, he also checked that whether this induction of current was associated with the motion of only magnet or the motion of both the coil and magnet. So he moved both coil and magnet in the same direction with the equal velocities, and he observed that there was no induced current in that case. Okay, so when he in these two cases, he moved them in the same direction with the equal velocity. Now again, I have not drawn the diagram, but he kept the bar magnet stationary, and he moved the coil towards the bar magnet or away from the bar magnet. Then also he observed some current induced in the coil. Now when he accelerated the magnet, in all these cases, he was moving the magnet or the coil with constant velocity, and the current observed in the coil was of constant magnitude also. And when he accelerated the magnet towards the coil, then the current was of increasing magnitude, and when he obviously when he moved the north pole and when he moved the south pole towards the coil, then only the changing factor in the current was its direction, and its magnitude was again increasing. Now when he ceased all the motions, then the instantaneous current was zero, and the instant when he ceased the motion, the current became zero. Now he also conducted another experiment in which he used two coils which were placed by some distance apart with each other. This is coil number one and this is coil number two. Now he used a galvanometer in coil number two, and he used a alternating current source in coil number one. Now you must be knowing that alternating current source is a AC generator. So he used this AC generator in this coil. And AC alternating current means that current would be changing its direction after a fixed time. So he observed that when he switched on this coil number 1, this circuit, then he observed that some current was also induced in this galvanometer, coil number 2. And also there was no physical contact or no electrical contact between them. And he conclusively created Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. Now he concluded that in all these experiments, the thing which was changing was the magnetic flux. So in this first case also, in the first experiment also, when he was moving both coil and bar magnet in the same direction with equal velocities, then the magnetic flux which is linked with this coil due to this bar magnet was in fact not changing. And when he was moving them relatively, when he was decreasing the distance between coil and the bar magnet, or when he was increasing the distance between coil and the bar magnet, then the magnetic flux linked with this coil was changing, and due to this change of magnetic flux, the EMF was induced in the coil, and induced EMF would be creating the current. Now similarly, in this case, when he used a DC source, direct current source, which is a constant current source, then he observed that when the current in coil number 1 was constant, then there was no induced EMF in this coil number 2, and there was no induced current. Obviously, current is a secondary factor. The primary factor is the EMF, and the EMF would generate the current to flow. Now, he observed that when the current flowing in coil number 1 was constant, then there was no induced EMF in coil number 2. So, finally, he concluded that whenever the magnetic flux linked with some conductor or coil will change, then some EMF will be induced in that conductor. And if that conductor is connected in a closed circuit, then that EMF would provoke the current to flow. And he finally concluded with 3 Faraday's law. The first law is whenever the magnetic flux linked with a loop changes, and whenever magnetic field lines are cut by some conducting wire or rod. This I would explain in the later part, that how EMF is induced when some magnetic field lines are cut by a wire or rod. This I will explain in later part. So the first law states that whenever the magnetic flux linked with some loop changes, and whenever the magnetic field lines are cut by some conducting wire or rod, then some EMF is induced in the loop or in the wire or rod that is cutting the field lines, and this induced EMF is also in fact known as induced EMF. Yeah. So the law number 2, this law states that the induced EMF will last only for the time for which the linked magnetic flux will change. So according to this second law, he concluded that till the time when the flux was changing, the EMF will induce, and the time, the instant of time at which the changing flux, the change of the flux will be ceased, then at the same time the EMF induced in the coil will become zero. So it does not matters that the flux is passing through a coil or not. In fact, the thing which matters is the fact that flux should pass through the coil, and as well as flux should change, which is associated with the coil should also change. So without changing the flux, the EMF will not be induced. So only the association of flux or a constant flux association is not enough to create the EMF. In fact, the flux association as well as the variation of flux is required for EMF induction. The third law, which he observed, that the magnitude of induced EMF is proportional to the rate of change of magnetic flux. So this was a very important conclusion, and I would be telling you the mathematical analysis by which the Faraday and Norman was able to verify this relation, that the EMF induced will be proportional to d phi by dt. And experimentally, as we have already discussed, that when Faraday accelerated the bar magnets towards the coil, then the current induced was continuously increasing or decreasing, and therefore due to the rate of change of flux, the EMF will change, and hence when this proportionality sign will disappear, then a negative sign came, and this negative sign was explained in detail by Lenz. So we would be discussing this significance of this negative sign in the next later part. Now this is Lenz's law and the law of conservation of energy. So this negative sign which I was talking about, that EMF induced is equal to minus d phi by dt, and this negative sign shows that the induced EMF will oppose the rate of change of magnetic flux. So this is a very important thing to know, that the nature of this induced EMF is like that it will oppose the cause of its induction. We all already know that the cause of induction of EMF is the changing flux. So the EMF induced in the coil will be opposing the changing flux, and if the flux is increasing, then the EMF induced due to that increasing flux will try to decrease that flux, and if the flux is decreasing, then the EMF induced due to that decreasing flux will try to increase that flux. All in all, we can say that the induced EMF will oppose the cause due to which it is induced. So to explain it with a better understanding, I would be demonstrating some examples. So now, first of all, I can tell you the law of conservation of energy, that why Lenz's law is also called as the law of conservation of energy, or I can say that why Lenz's law obeys the laws of conservation of energy. So in this case, you can see there is a coil, and this is a bar magnet which is moving towards the coil, facing its north pole towards the coil. So when this north pole is moving towards the coil, then this coil will experience some induced EMF, and therefore some induced current in it, and that current and EMF, according to Lenz's law, will oppose its cause of induction. Now the cause of induction of this EMF is the movement of north pole towards the coil. This north pole is moving towards the coil, therefore this EMF is induced. Now the induced EMF will try that this cause of induction is opposed, and it will try to repel the north pole because it is induced due to the movement of north pole towards the coil. Therefore it would oppose the movement of north pole towards the coil, and it would be repelling this north pole. Now to repel this north pole, this coil will be having a current which is in anti-clockwise sense. This is a anti-clockwise ACW current. So anti-clockwise current will show the north pole here and the south pole on the back side. So this north pole will repel this north pole, and similarly, if we will move this north pole away from this coil, then the induced EMF will try to attract this north pole towards it, and therefore a clockwise current will be induced in this coil, and a south pole will be showing at this phase, and there will be a north pole at this phase. So where is the law of conservation of energy? Now you can see that if you are moving this bar magnet toward the coil and you are external source, so you would be applying some force to move this bar magnet towards the coil, and you are doing some work against this repulsion because this coil will repel this bar magnet. So you are doing some work against this repulsion. So the work done by you, you are an external agent. So work done by you will be stored, will be converted into the form of electrical energy, and it would be appearing in this coil in the form of current. So the work done by this external force is being converted into electrical energy, and it is appearing in this coil in form of current. So this law of conservation of energy is exactly valid here. If we do not apply any force on this bar magnet, then eventually this bar magnet will come to rest. And if it would come to rest, then the flux linked with the coil will not change, and therefore no EMF and no current will be induced in the coil. And if no current is induced in the coil, there is no conversion of no electrical energy which is appearing in this coil. And it is also obviously correct, because if we are not applying any force on the bar magnet, then we are not doing any work on the bar magnet, and hence if no work is being done, then no energy will be generated in the coil. So this is the law of conservation of energy. And in CBSE 12th board exams, or in RBSE, or in any other boards of India, if this question comes that why Lenz's law follows the law of conservation of energy, you can explain this example and you can write it in your words. Now to explain the nature of EMF, which is analyzed by Lenz, I am taking some examples. So the first example is the case in which we have to predict the direction of current in the coil. So when this north pole is moving towards the coil, then this coil will have a EMF which will try to repel this north pole, because this north pole is moving towards the coil, and EMF induced will be opposing the motion of north pole towards the coil, and hence it would be repelling this north pole. Therefore, to repel the north pole, it will show the north pole on this face, and hence the current will be in anti-clockwise sense, ACW. If this south pole is moving towards the coil, then this coil will oppose the south pole to move towards it, and it would repel the south pole, and to repel the south pole, it will show the south pole on this face, so that south will repel the south, and therefore the induced current will be clockwise. You must know that if I'm drawing it here, that if a coil is having a current which is anti-clockwise, then it is a bar magnet which is having a north pole towards on this face, and if you are watching this coil from the back side, then this current would be clockwise, and hence the south pole will be formed. So if the current flowing in the coil is anti-clockwise, then you are watching the north pole, and if that current is clockwise, then you are watching the south pole. Okay. Now similarly, if this north pole is moving away, then this coil will try to attract this north pole because it is moving away. So to attract this north pole, this coil will show the south pole, and hence a clockwise current will be induced. And if this south pole is moving away, then this coil will try to attract the south pole, and to attract that, it would be creating a anti-clockwise current, ACW. Okay. Now in this question, in this example, there is a magnetic field which is dot. Now this direction of magnetic field is towards the observer, towards you, coming out of this screen, and this cross means it is going away from you, perpendicular to the screen. So in this case, the magnetic field is coming towards the observer. So in this case, this rod is moving in this direction with some velocity, and we have to predict the direction of induced current. And we also can check that whether the current will be induced or not. So you can see that flux is equal to B dot A. Now A is the area vector, and the magnitude of area vector is the area of the loop. Now you can see that this loop will be having a increasing area when this rod is moving in that this direction. So when this rod is moving towards right, then the area of this loop will be increasing, and the flux linked with this loop will be increasing, because more and more number of field lines will be associated with this loop. So if this flux is increasing, then the induced current will be trying to decrease this flux, because it always opposes the cause of induction. So induced current would be trying to decrease this flux. So this flux is coming out of the screen, and hence to decrease this flux, the induced current will be creating a flux which will be going inside the screen. So induced current will be creating a magnetic field which would be pointing in the direction which is towards the screen and going inside the screen, and hence the induced current would be in clockwise sense, because this is induced current, because this clockwise direction of current will be creating a magnetic field which is going inside the plane. Therefore, to oppose the flux which is coming out of the plane, the magnetic field which would be induced will be in the direction which is going inside the plane. So the induced current would be in clockwise sense. Okay. Now in this case, you can see that there is a long, infinitely long wire which is having a current which is continuously increasing, and a coil which is placed in the same plane of that wire, and we have to predict the direction of induced current in this coil. Now you can see by the Fleming's right hand rule that if the current flowing in this wire is in towards right side, then the magnetic field which would be crossing this coil will be inside the plane of the screen. This is by Fleming's right hand palm rule. Okay, so the magnetic field will be inside the plane of the screen. So this magnetic field is associated with this current, and obviously current is increasing, therefore this magnetic field is also increasing, and therefore the flux associated with this loop is also increasing. Now you have to analyze that this increasing flux is in the direction which is going inside this plane, and to oppose this increment of the flux, the induced current would be creating its own flux in the opposite direction. So the induced current would be induced in such a way such that the induced magnetic field due to that current will be in the opposite direction of this magnetic field. So induced current would be in anti-clockwise sense, so that this is induced current, ACW sense, so that the magnetic field which is induced in this loop will be coming out of this screen, and this magnetic field would be opposing the magnetic flux which is going inside the plane. Okay. Now in this case, this wire is passing through the diameter of this coil, and this wire is not touching any part of the coil. Now we can see, we have to find out the direction of induced current. Now we can see that the magnetic flux which would be linked in the upper half of this coil will be coming out of the plane. Again, you can check it with the direction, check the direction with the Fleming's right hand palm rule. And the magnetic flux which is linked with the lower half of this coil will be cross. Your fingers will be pointing in the downward direction when you are holding this wire in your right hand palm and your thumb is pointing in the direction of current, then your fingers will be pointing in the downward direction inside the plane in the lower half part of this loop. So this flux is positive because outgoing flux is always taken as positive and this is a negative flux. Ingoing flux is taken as negative. Now I will tell this because tell you this fact that flux is B dot A. Now we all know that area vector is always towards the observer. So if magnetic field, if theta is zero, the angle between B and A, then flux will be positive, which means the area vector and magnetic field are in same direction. And due to the fact that magnetic field area vector is coming towards the observer, so the magnetic field which is coming towards the observer will have a positive flux. And if this theta is 180 degree, then the flux would be negative because area vector is coming towards the observer and magnetic field is going away from the observer. So in this case the total flux will be zero because the amount of flux which is coming out of the plane is equal to the amount of flux which is going inside this plane through the loop, and therefore the total flux associated with this loop will be zero, and hence there would be no current induced in the loop. But if this wire is passing is not passing through the diameter, in fact it is passing through any chord of this loop, then we can again write down the direction that the current in this smaller part, the field magnetic flux in this smaller part will be coming out of the plane, and the magnetic flux in this greater part will be going inside the plane. So you can see that the negative flux, this is phi 2 and this is plus phi 1. So magnitude of phi 2 is greater than magnitude of phi 1. And you can see that the net flux will be obviously negative because the greater flux is the negative flux, and hence the net flux would be negative. Now this net flux is increasing because current is increasing, and negative flux means this flux is going inside the plane. So to oppose this increment of flux, the induced current will be inducing its magnetic field in the opposite direction of this flux. So to create the magnetic field in the direction which is outside the plane of this screen, the induced current would be in anti-clockwise sense. This is induced current in the loop, and this will be in anti-clockwise sense to create the magnetic flux outside the plane, because this flux which is increasing is pointing inside the plane, and hence to decrease that to oppose that increment of flux, the induced current would be creating its magnetic flux which is coming out of the screen. So it would be anti-clockwise. Now in this case, this was also a question which is previously asked in physics Olympiad, that there are two types of coils which are kept in magnetic field, and this magnetic field is increasing. So you can see that if any current which is induced in this bigger coil is, let's suppose it is anti-clockwise, then this current will flow like that in the smaller coil. So if the current in the upper coil is ACW, then the current in a smaller coil will be CW, clockwise, because they are anti-coupled. Anti-coupling means the direction of current in both the coils will be definitely opposite to each other. But to check whether that the net induced current would be in clockwise or anti-clockwise sense, so we can say that that the bigger area is of this coil, bigger coil, and let's suppose its area is A2 and its area is A1. So A2 is greater than A1. Therefore, flux associated with the bigger coil would be greater than the flux associated with the smaller coil. And hence, the induced current would be opposing the flux of bigger coil. So the flux which is associated with the bigger coil is in the direction which is going inside the plane, and this magnetic field which is pointing inside the plane is increasing. Therefore, to decrease this magnetic field, the current induced in the bigger coil would be anti-clockwise, because anti-clockwise current will be creating its magnetic field which is pointing towards the observer, which is coming out of this screen, and hence if anti-clockwise current is induced in the bigger coil, then this current will be flowing in a clockwise sense in the smaller coil. Okay, so in these kind of questions you should find out the direction of induced current in according to the flux linked with the bigger coil. So here the flux linked with the bigger coil is this, and we are inducing the current which is opposing the flux linked with the bigger coil. Okay. Now this was the complete lecture 1 on electromagnetic induction, and I hope you will be solving some questions on these direction, prediction of the direction of current, and by solving these questions yourself you would be getting a better understanding of the topic. Thank you.